So, of the Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, that text which everyone knows with their eyes and finds it very difficult to speak. Her book on the text, for which we congratulate her, is in fact this year's winner of the American Institute of Architects Award in the category of the History of Architecture, for which we'd like to congratulate her. Liane Lefaivre is a research associate in the Design Knowledge Systems Group in the Department of Architecture at the Technical University of Delft in the Netherlands. And her work has been devoted to the study of architectural culture and architectural criticism in the framework of what she and the department conceive of as cognitive history, architectural history, creativity, and the kind of cognitive conceptual aspects of the modern in Western culture. Her own work covers sort of basically two periods, the early modern Renaissance up to about the French Revolution, and the contemporary since the Second World War. And she's written widely and published widely in that area. Among the books she's published are the documentary histories of the humanist tradition in architecture from the early Renaissance to the end of the 18th century, The Origins of Modern Architecture, Architectural Thinking, and a cognitive analysis entitled Classical Architecture, The Poetics of Order. All these were carried out in collaboration with Alexander Tzonis. With regard to contemporary architectural criticism and theory, she introduced the term dirty realism into architecture and collaborated with Alexander in introducing the concept of populism, critical regionalism, and skin rigorism, which have been kind of widely debated and discussed. Among her recent books are Architecture in North America since 1960, together with Alex Zonis, now in paperback, Movement and Structure in the Work of Santiago Calatrava, again in collaboration with Alex Zonis. Her latest book, the book that we're going to discuss this evening, is entitled Leon Battista Alberti's Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, Re-Cognizing the Architectural Body in the Early Italian Renaissance, which, as I've said, has been the winner of this year's American Institute of Architects Award. It's with great pleasure that we welcome Liane Lefaivre. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mark, for your kind words. And I'd like to also thank MIT Press, and in particular Anne Twiselton, for helping to organize tonight's lecture. I'd also like to announce that after this lecture, Asaf Friedman, one of the site designers of the electronic version of the Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, which is featured both on the homepage of MIT Press and of the DKS group of Technical University of Delft, will give a demonstration to anybody who would like to explore the first electronic Renaissance architectural treatise. To begin, about the Hypnerotomachia Poliphili. In many ways, it's nondescript. Published in 1499, the book is modeled on the idyllic, pastoral, bucolic Romanzo d'Amore, a tradition that had peaked over a century earlier in its universally acknowledged master, Giovanni Boccaccio. The Hypnerotomachia Poliphili is an anachronism. Moreover, it adds nothing new to the amorous imagery. It brings together all the stereotypical characters traditionally associated with what was by then a highly stylized genre. The enamored hero and the indifferent heroine, attended by scores of stock characters, nymphs, naiads, satyrs, goddesses, demigods, who, all too predictably, sing, dance, give advice, and in general, eagerly officiate whenever there's opportunity for lovers to engage in a rite of union. Its settings bow to the invariable formula of verdant glades, babbling brooks, and enclosed gardens. As for the plot, it too conforms to the conventions of the times, of the genre's time-worn topoi. The lover's unrequited love, his quest to win the heart of the heroine, love's triumph. The action takes place in a dream, as you probably all know, and the book opens on the hero who has spent a restless night because his beloved Pollio has shunned him. At the break of the day, he's to embark on his love quest. He falls into a deep slumber, and his hypnerotomachia, as it roughly can be translated, struggle for love in a dream begins. The action is particularly absurd, however, even by the standards of the genre. Poliphilo is transported into a wild forest. He gets lost, escapes, and falls asleep again. He awakens in a second dream, dreamed inside the first. Within it, he's taken by some nymphs to meet their queen. There, he's asked to declare his love for Polia, which he does. He's then directed by two nymphs to three gates. He chooses the third, behind which he finds his beloved. They are taken by more nymphs to a temple to be engaged, and etc. The narrative is interrupted. A second voice takes over as Polia herself describes the erotomachia from her own point of view. Benedetto Croce, one of this century's most prominent philosophers and Renaissance scholars, wrote about this boring book, that if this book had not been so serious and so long, it might well have been interpreted as a caricature of humanism. William Evans, the famous American historian of printmaking, dismissed it as a dull, unreadable romance. Roberto Weiss, the Renaissance historian, as a serious runner-up for the most boring book in Italian literature. In the words of Italian scholar Francesco Fabbrini, it represented no less than the complete dissolution of an entire literary world, that of the romance, that of the Italian romanzo d'amore. The one of the features that readers have found interesting is the beauty of the book. Indeed, one of the features of the Hypnerotomachia that has attracted the attention of scholars has been its use of the famed Aldine Roman type front, invented by Nicholas Jensen. The font, usually viewed as originating in the efforts of the humanist leftovers of belles lettres and renowned calligraphers such as Petrarch and Poggio Bracciolini, appeared for the first time in Bembo's De Etna, and in a second, more perfected version in the Hypnerotomachia Poliphili. Technically, this achievement consists in having carried out a reduction in the relative weight and of the lowercase fonts, creating what the historian Stanley Morrison has called a superbly harmonic effect. Also, it has been pointed out that the capitals of the Hypnerotomachia have a relative height and weight governed by a 1-to-10 proportion recommended by Feliciano in the Renaissance. Equally admired is the particular care lavished on the decorated initials. Some are in hatchwork, while others, still finer, are decorated in strapwork or tendrilled foliage and flowers. The 172 woodcuts of the Hypnerotomachia, are at least as well studied and they're and admired. Here we have the appearance for the first time of Greek and Arabic fonts in a Renaissance book. Small wonder that there's a widespread consensus among scholars that the Hypnerotomachia is the most hauntingly beautiful of all illustrated incunabulae, perhaps the most beautiful book of all time, with its 30 or so copies still in existence in private and public collections. It's also the most sought after. Besides being beautiful, the book is also erudite. Indeed, it's looked on as providing an architectural knowledge base. It's the most systematic and richest work of the Renaissance. To begin, far from being limited to architecture, the astounding level of erudition of the Hypnerotomachia extends to other fields. No person, no place, no thing is represented without reference to classical mythology, classical geography, and classical art. The story offers its own interpretation on every page by referring to a vast amount of scholarly detail. The range of topics is exhaustive. Music, musical instruments, ars topiaria, statuary, fountains, mosaic, geometry, the effects of distance on the perception of color, epitaphs, furniture, wood, wine, opera, food, choreography, ritual processions, and botany. The admiration among scholars for the quantity of learning in the Hypnerotomachia is unanimous. It is, as its prodigious display of knowledge has been universally acknowledged, the book has been characterized as an encyclopedia of all artistic, archaeological, and technological knowledge of the 15th century. An encyclopedia of the knowledge held at the time by a small group of people schooled in the most advanced, in all that was known and more. It is hailed as the most advanced voice at humanism at its most fanatic stage. But there's another overlooked part of the Hypnerotomachia, and that is the fact that it is as erotic as it is erudite. Let us begin with the level of, at the level of the construction of the hero. Poliphilo descends from the traditional, stereotypical protagonist of the romanzo. This means that, like the heroes of his predecessors, he breaks with the tradition of the chivalrous warrior of the epic and is instead a hero in the dolce stil nuovo, who by definition grapples with his amorous feelings rather than with an enemy army. But Poliphilo is more extreme than his colleagues and his oppositions to the, in his oppositions to the chivalric ideal. He was over emphatically a coward. When faced with the alternatives, when he sees a dragon, he refuses to confront it and flees. When faced with the alternative of vita activa, personified by a person in military armor, he refuses. Even the sight of nymphs scare him. He's polemically pacifistic, repeatedly stresses his elation when he sees Eros trampling weapons underfoot, Mars making love to Venus instead of war, and banners bearing amor vincit omnia. Like the heroes of De Meung, his predecessors, like Boccaccio, Poliphilo loves his beloved for her virtuous and beautiful spirit. But while they are extraordinarily chaste, in the words of Bakhtin when he describes the traditional romanzo, he is hypererotic. For him, Polia may be a bellissima psyche. She occupies his soul non senza concupiscentia. And above all, he's attracted to her virginal and divine little body. His gaze is constantly drawn to it because of her diaphanous garments that flutter in breezes, as in a Botticelli painting. For instance, when they reach the island of Cythera, he follows behind her and notes that I lowered my eyes now and then to see her feet. Sometimes it would come to pass that the wind would make her clothes flutter and uncover her legs that seemed to be made of scarlet, milk, and music all mixed together. Again and again, he describes her physical beauty with grandiloquent strings of superlatives, extending over many paragraphs. The first time he catches sight of her, for example, so great is her beautiful demeanor and attitude that never did the amorous idyllia appear so de Mars, etc. Poliphilo never tires of her body and mentions it whenever he can. In the end, these descriptions occupy 50 pages of the book's narrative with an insistence that is... with an insistence that is almost militant. Poliphilo's hyper-eroticism is not limited to Polia, however. His gaze is also constantly drawn to the bodies of other nymphs, also clad in garments that also flutter in breezes. He kisses 5 of them and takes off his clothes and goes swimming in the nude with them, and then has an orgy with them. Finally, in even greater opposition to all other heroes of the Romanzo d'Amore, Poliphilo is not blind to those of the same sex, and the illustrations of 6 erect phalluses in the book are one more expression of his inordinate, hyperbolic, polyphilian eroticism. At the level of the construction of the heroine, too, there's a striking degree of eroticism. Whereas Petrarch's Laura and Dante's Beatrice were chaste objects of desire, Polia is a carnal creature. Like Laura and Beatrice, she's in love with the hero. But unlike them, she is unchaste. Polia is no angel. She interrupts Poliphilo's narrative, in which she, curiously enough, almost totally silent for the rest of the book, recounts the story from her own point of view, taking the opportunity to launch into a tirade against the principle of chastity in women. She has at least as much, if not more, erotic furore as the hero, and her polemical defense of a woman's right to pursue erotic pleasure, voluptas, fills almost 1/5 of the book. It is almost a verbatim citation of Boccaccio's Fiammetta, but to exactly the opposite effect. Fiammetta is the tragic, passive victim of unrequited love, while Polia is the triumphant, active, even wild heroine of her own erotomachia. In this regard, she also differs from the promiscuous ladies of Boccaccio's Decameron. Whereas they were simply indulging in the pleasures of the flesh, she makes a general case in support of female sexuality, lifting the topic from mere ribaldry onto the more daring plane of sexual politics. As opposed to Poliphilo's narrative, in addition, Poliphilo's is serious in tone. In this barely veiled parody of 13th and 14th century tradition of the love story, which makes up Poliphilo's part of the novel, the quest for hedonism and mutual seduction take the hero and heroine through a series of mock heroic predicaments. The name Poliphilo means lover of many things. The name Polia, in turn, means many things. Means many things. To be sure, Poliphilo does love many things besides Polia. But he loves architecture most, and he loves it as much as he loves Polia, and in the same carnal way. In fact, one after the other, the buildings described in the book become objects of desire themselves, metaphors for Polia's solido corpo. Indeed, among the dreamlike features of the buildings is the inordinate feeling of happiness they impart to the beholder. Poliphilo characterizes the marble of the triumphal arch as virginal. The veinless marble of another surface is flawless, which is the same term he describes used to describe the skin of a certain nymph. Upon seeing the buildings, Poliphilo feels extreme delight, incredible joy, frenetic pleasure, and cupidinous frenzy. Buildings fill him with the highest carnal pleasure and with a burning lust. He loves them not just because they're beautiful to behold, but also because they are fragrant and agreeable to touch. He partakes of their pleasures with all his senses. In front of a frieze of a sleeping nymph, he cannot keep from placing his hand on her knees and fondling and squeezing them, nor can he resist pressing his lips to her breasts and sucking them. The sexuality of the buildings Poliphilo loves is polymorphic. He approvingly describes the columns of a certain temple as hermaphroditic because they combine male and female characteristics. The altar of Bacchus is made of a highly veined marble, especially selected to express, in his words, the virility of that deity, which is carved with a great phallus, which is rigorous. Above the reclining nude body, of a sleeping nymph, leers a naked satyr with a watchful eye and also an erect penis. The erotization of architecture comes to its logical conclusion. In three cases, Poliphilo manages to locate the orifice through which he can engage in sexual congress with specific buildings. His response, always described at length and in much detail, is sheer coital ecstasy. And in one instance, the effect on the building is mutual. The unbridled eroticism of the Hypnerotomachia extends to the illustrations, many of which have been censored as pornographic. Oh, here he is making love to the buildings. Many of which have been censored as pornographic, surely a reaction unique in the history of architectural publishing. Among the objectionable images to have been either erased or inked over in the collection of the Vatican Library, for instance, are the emblem of a priapic Hermes, the leg of an elephant mistaken for the genital organ of its neighbor, and at the same time the seduction of Leda by the swan, Bacchus's phallus, Polia kissing Poliphilo, who is seated, who she has managed to drag up on her own lap, and a nymph's nudity, which has been covered by a skirt. Closer reading of the Hypnerotomachia reveals that this hypereroticism is not only the raison d'etre of the characters and the subject matter of the illustrations. It is the moving force of the plot. There are no other actions, actors, motivations, measures of suspense, fulfillments, or failures. Each episode illustrates the same principle, as almost all the actions are reduced to the repetition of one basic formula: a man desires an object. Most fundamentally, it is bodies and buildings that he seeks, and his behavior makes no distinction between them. He experiences buildings in terms of desirable bodies, and so do we as readers. We apprehend buildings through Poliphilo's actions, through his viewing them, nearing them, coming into sensual contact with them, and departing from them. Thus it is clear that the story is structured on the basic metaphor, the building as a desirable erotic body. The entire plot appears as nothing more than the instantiation of that one continued metaphor, to quote Quintilian. More than a love story, then, the Hypnerotomachia is a string of situations that afford the author excuses to vent a militant and frenetic eroticism, very close in spirit, though in a dreamlike and hypertrophic way, to Lorenzo Valla's Manifesto di Voluptate. Again and again, the topos, omnia vincit amor, is hammered home. In the processions, the hero witnesses. Here they are. Omnia vincit amor. In the six processions, the hero witnesses, not to mention the many idyllic scenes he describes between nymphs and youths, orgiastic singing and dancing, the rape of Ganymede by Zeus, the love scenes between mothers and sons. Eros shapes the narrative at every level of the book's composition. So intense and so exaggerated is the eroticism of the Hypnerotomachia that at a certain point it ceases to be just a piece of erotic writing and becomes a writing about eroticism. It becomes an erotic manifesto, an erotomachic manifesto, a hyper-erotomachic manifesto. Why would Leon Battista Alberti, who projected such a supremely rational, reasoned persona in his writings, have written such a wildly erotic book, so different from his well-known De Reedificatoria? There's a long tradition, interestingly, in juxtaposing these two works. And it starts with Alberti's the first biographer, Girolamo Mancini, who brought up the Hypnerotomachia in the middle of his biography only to deny any connection between that book and the rest of the Hypnerotomachia and the rest of the works of Alberti. And strangely, it's the only book that he brings up out in this context. Manfredo Tafuri is probably the last scholar in this tradition to juxtapose the two in order to stress how impossible it would have been for Alberti to have written this kind of book. It's not the first time that the connection between Alberti and the Hypnerotomachia has been made, of course. Emanuela Quechulescu Coranta has made this connection in her work. It's not my purpose here to go into to arguments about the attribution, about whether or not he wrote the book of the Hypnerotomachia. Instead, I'd like to look at the Hypnerotomachia within the framework of architectural cognition and cognitive history, and to look at it as the forma mentis of one of the most creative minds in Western architectural history, and at a period when our own Western concept of modernity was born, and at the role of the metaphor of the architectural body in the conceptual revolution that occurred at that time. The Hypnerotomachia, of course, is a compendium, can be seen as a compendium of everything Alberti knew, and he knew a lot. He knew as much as everybody else knew in the Renaissance. It was probably the last time that one person's mind was big enough to encompass all the knowledge of his or her contemporaries. As I show in my own book, the Hypnerotomachia contains his knowledge, all his knowledge of poetry, all his knowledge of which he was. He was a poet. All his knowledge of novels, he was a novelist. All his knowledge of engineering, all his novels of architecture, and all his knowledge in visual thinking. And I want to go into a little bit of detail here. I won't go into any other detail. I won't go into how all of the different types of knowledge that he presents in the Hypnerotomachia, that he packs into the Hypnerotomachia, but I think it might be interesting to look at the type of visual thinking, his knowledge about visual thinking, his theories about visual thinking that he puts in the Hypnerotomachia. After all, he is one of the most important thinkers about vision in history. First of all, he invented perspective. In particular, and he puts everything he knew about his invention that he'd already presented in his De la Pittura here, and at even greater lengths. He spends 50 pages describing what one building looks like, and it's the logic of the narrative is completely visual. He describes all the lines of vision that he didn't do in the De la Pittura in the Hypnerotomachia. But we also know that he was interested in representing not only static images, but moving ones. Alberti, in fact, was obsessed with representing movement. So great was, and he writes a lot, almost half of his De la Pittura is taken up with a discussion of movement and how important it is, and he even says, if a painter can represent movement, that's the most important part of the painter's work. So great was Alberti's obsession with representing movement that it drove him, apparently, beyond the surface of paintings to his experiments with a box they invented to capture truly moving pictures. What in his De Pictura and his autobiography, written anonymously, he called his dimostrazioni, or miracoli. These represent one of the earliest steps in the invention of cinema. Cinema that is not just in the sense of a projected image, but in the sense of capturing kinesis, the moving image. There'd been predecessors, I won't go into those, but the importance of this invention did not escape his near contemporaries, such as Giorgio Vasari, begrudging as he was about Alberti in general. He compares the invention to the printing press by John Gutenberg. In the year following, he writes about Alberti, 1457, in which John Gutenberg, a German, discovered the most useful part of printing books, Leon Battista Alberti likewise made a discovery for representing landscapes and for diminishing and enlarging figures by means of an instrument. Quatremer de Quincy also suggested that Alberti's invention was as important as the printing press. According to him, this invention multiplies the pleasures of a work of art and of nature and transports, one might say, whole regions, their inhabitants, their costumes, the monuments of remote regions, and establishes in the world a reciprocity and a mingling of knowledge that exercises the same power as newspaper does on one's ideas. The exact workings of this invention have always been a mystery to scholars. Alberti's own description is unclear and confusing. In his autobiography, he had talked about his dimostrazioni as miracles of paintings of my own making, which several of my companions saw in Rome. And again, in the third person, he writes of himself that with his art of painting, Alberti produced things unheard of and unbelievable to those who saw them. These works he displayed in a small box through a tiny hole. You saw their high mountains, vast provinces, the broad moving sea, and at the same time a vista of such distant regions that they were barely discernible. Both learned and unlearned alike swore that these were things of nature, not painted. The dimostrazioni were of two kinds, one sunny and the other nocturnal. There one could see Arthur, the Pleiades, Orion, and the similar sparkling constellation, and the moon rising from the crests, craggy mountains, and the morning stars. In the sunny one, the orb of the earth was resplendent and amply illuminated with a surface that shines like Aurora, the mother of light. Alberti, speaking of himself, would have Greek sailors look at it, and having shown them this imaginary world through the little hole and having asked them what they saw, they would answer, "We see a fleet on the high sea preparing to land, but hail, winds, and violent storms are arising from the east and preventing it from doing so. The sea is rough and looks threatening because of the excessive reflections of the rays of the sun. Moreover," that's what he said. He wasn't interested in disclosing this. What was behind this miracle? This dimostrazione. Some scholars have described this box as the camera obscura, the forerunner of the modern still camera. But Alberti's invention is probably what will become known in the 17th century as a lanterna magica, the true predecessor of cinema. Although Alberti's cinematic visions left no real trace in his real architecture, they would explain some novelties in the Hypnerotomachia. Here, animation is incorporated into many buildings or parts of buildings, thanks to the ingenious mechanical devices they contain. But there are three other cases of buildings of the hypnerotomachia are cinematic in another, even more surprising way. In the first, there's a myriad multicolored fish, multicolored fish depicted on the mosaic pattern of the swimming pool, come illusionistically to life as they are projected onto the surface of the water, which serves as a moving silvery picture screen, illuminated by the lacy glass and copper cupola above it. In the second, the moving pictures of a skirmish are projected onto the walls of a round temple of Venus. I hope I've got the... Oh, this is his obsession with movement. This is how he incorporates movement into the design of his pages. This is a moving picture. This is the projector that he used in his for his moving. Moving images of a skirmish are projected onto the walls of a round temple from a huge etched light bulb in the center of the chamber, transforming the interior of the structure into a perfect 360-degree screen. In the third case, the floor of an amphitheater in the center of an island of Cythera captures the images of nymphs dancing upon it. It's a kind of mirror that captures the images of nymphs dancing upon it, and is capable of remembering, quote unquote, these images. This is a remarkable mental leap of the imagination for someone writing in the mid-15th century, for the writer must have conceived of the possibility of preserving moving images on a photosensitive surface. One could say that the building is thought of as part of an immense video camera whose lens and screen are the floor. But perhaps more important, the perception, representation, and conception of the buildings in the book are shaped by a cinematic forma mentis. The result is that the hypnerotomachia contains the first description of architectural space, which by definition needs movement in order to be perceived in history. It's not only the first illustrated architecture book, it is, cognitively at least, the first architectural film. And its integration of text and image is nothing short of cinematographic. Just look at the filmic sequence representing the, I'm not going to tell you that, that one's after. There's a cinematic sequence of images that describe one episode. There are nine images and they describe almost like a film, like frames on a film, what happens. And it's in fact his seduction of the temple. It's when he is figured metaphorically making love to the building, and the building is having an orgasm. And it's interesting that he chose to prolong, instead of represented by one image, to nine separate images. And this is another cinematic sequence unheard of in publishing in the Renaissance, which is also like three frames in a film. The remarkably innovative visual, this is the logic of animation. It's not the logic simply of book illustration. The remarkably innovative visual character of the hypnerotomachia is no doubt one of the reasons the book is so hard to read. The book is written by a person who is using visual rather than narrative logic to structure the tale. I'm not going to go into that. But the hypnerotomachia is more than a mere catalog of knowledge, of data. It is structured very much like the buildings themselves that are described in the hypnerotomachia. However staggering its degree of learning, the book is not weighed down by repetition of facts and obedience to authority. The scholarship in the book is used as a springboard for leaps of the imagination. If the author does display a peerless mastery of antique precedents, it is all the better to take liberties with them. Hypnerotomachia is in line with antique tradition, but only up to a point. Moving beyond the simple knowledge base of precedence in antiquity, the book offers a new system of rules for designing with precedence. It provides not just a depository of architectural memories, but a method for reusing memories creatively. A genetic method, or, to take some poetic license, an algorithm. The Hypnerotomachia unfolds in a dream world, a world where new associations are born. The book is filled with extraordinary dream props. They are strange in relation to the real world and to the world of antiquity, but not in the hypnotic, oniric world of the Hypnerotomachia. After all, the first part of the book's title, Hypnos, means sleep, and the kind of recombinant mixing that characterizes dreams is typical of the Hypnerotomachia at every level of composition. Like what Freud called dream structures, these design objects tend to follow a logic of their own. As products of the dream work, they are shaped by a combinatorial mathematics that negates contradictions between elements that by definition are mutually exclusive in normal waking life. They are new, previously unthinkable composite structures made up of elements that could not otherwise have been brought together. In Freud's words, they disregard the no. Anything can be combined, in particular contraries, in Freud's words, contraries, especially elements which in our waking thoughts we should certainly have kept separate. Dreams, of course, are privileged settings in which to carry out thought experiments, to use Thomas Kuhn's term, offering a place within which mental leaps and wild thinking can take place. Taking place in an imagined situation, dreams provide a cognitive apparatus that eliminates the condition of verisimilitude and thus permits reformulation of existing concepts. This combinatorial logic, according to, well, is the main, Alex Tzonis, is in a work that he's preparing, is the main way that architectural creativity works. New design ideas are born not ex nihilo, but out of the recombination of precedents. By bringing together precedents in an unprecedented way, creative design uses memory and knowledge as a basis for innovatively combining elements. What is interesting about the Hypnerotomachia is that here this mechanism is so dominant in its reiterations. Indeed, there's no structure that is not put together this way. It almost seems that the author has isolated this genetic algorithm and put it to use in all his buildings. Moreover, it is as if he were conscious of this method and were using the book to theorize that creative design is precisely this process of rethinking and recategorizing precedent works. Take the first dream structure. It is a shocking aberration. It's a part temple, part triumphal arch, part pyramid, part obelisk, part sphere, part labyrinth, part propyleum, part obelisk, part, have I said that? Yes. Part mountain, and something that could be a hippodrome. A baffled Poliphilo is at pains to identify the nature of the last building, which is in ruins. It could be all kinds of things, not that it matters much. All the buildings are incongruous in this context. And he describes all the other, he describes seven or eight other buildings which are equally, which also break the architectural no, which are denials of the architectural no. They break, there's one building which breaks down the barrier between architecture and the body, in the and the building is in the form of a body. There's a building which is part garden and part temple. And in the garden is isn't horizontal, it's vertical. and the pathway through the garden follows the vertical path, et cetera, et cetera. This same extraordinary combinatorial structure is also, when you come to think of it, like Alberti's own buildings. There are indeed great similarities between the buildings, the hybrid buildings of the Hypnerotomachia and his buildings, the extraordinary recombinant logic at work in the design of the buildings is strikingly similar to that in the buildings Alberti designed in real life. It's hard to imagine what could have been more disconcerting in the mid-Quattrocento than the facade of Santa Maria Novella. To begin with, it piles a classical temple on top of an older Gothic church facade, the two buildings' elements being totally at odds with one another. Compounding the incongruity, irregularities abound in the facade. The triangular pediment of the building, for example, seems to be resting on the columns. Seem to be resting on the gigantic circular window below instead of on a colonnade. Then, the devices that serve to attach the temple facade to the Gothic facade are too bizarre and immense, never before used in any other building, curvaceously serpentine volutes. The Tempio Malatistiano is another unprecedented combination of precedents that Rudolf Witkover called a daring experiment in joining incompatible motifs. The sides of the building emulate a Roman aqueduct, and the facade mimics a triumphal arch. The strange amalgam is surmounted by something resembling the dome of the Pantheon. In the same highly unconventional spirit, the Church of San Andrea in Mantua is based on a combination of the Basilica of Maxentius Constantine and the Baths of Diocletian. And the Church of San Sebastiano makes bedfellows of a triumphal arch and the Temple of Theodoric in Ravenna. As for the Rucellai Sepulchre in the Church of San Pancrazio, it juxtaposes elements of Oriental, so-called, architecture from the Holy Land with regional Tuscan forms. The Piazza of Pienza, with its eccentric combination of classical and Gothic elements, is a similar case. On a much smaller case, Alberti personally designed a base for an equestrian statue in Ferrara for Leonello d'Este in the surprising form of a triumphal arch, a horse on top of a triumphal arch. Witkover was correct in noting that in such projects, the purest approach to classical architecture gave way to a deliberate and free combination of its elements, and that classical architecture became a storehouse which supplied him with the material for the free and subjective planning of architecture. No wonder Cardinal Gonzaga qualified Alberti's style at the time as fantastic, and Luca Fancelli, his fellow architect and collaborator, as wonderful. It is through such daring leaps of the architectural imagination that he became one of the most influential architects of all time. Indeed, he is responsible for adapting the antique classical architecture to the new building types of the Renaissance. There is no classicizing facade of the last 500 years that does not owe a debt to these projects of Alberti's. This recombinant tendency is everywhere evident in Alberti's vast output, which reflects his tendency to make new composite structures out of different, often widely divergent and even mutually exclusive elements. His subjects varied widely, as we have seen, from mechanics and engineering to an essay on horses and a biography of his dog, to works on how to govern wisely. Not only was Alberti's output composite as a whole, but even individual works tended to be material put together in unprecedented ways. Intercennales, for example, a collection of 43 extremely heterogeneous pieces of varying lengths, comprises dialogues, dreams, fables, allegories, apologias, and short stories. It is divided into 11 books. It is dedicated in part to Leonardo Bruni and Poggio Bracciolini, purely literary figures, and in part to Paolo Toscanelli, the greatest mathematician of his day. De Pictura, where Alberti expounds for the first time his theory of perspective, is a similarly mixed treatise based partly on painting and partly on mathematics, as Alberti himself warns the reader in his introductory remarks. In this context, the exceptionally hybrid nature of the Hypnerotomachia, part fiction, part learned exposition, appears to be more the rule than an exception in Alberti's corpus. This combinatorial character of Alberti's vast output is not a matter of chance. It derives from a well thought out formula. As Joan Gadol has pointed out, did he not fruitfully reuse navigational instrument, the astrolabe, in applying it to land surveying? Did he not use the same instrument to measure the human body in the statua? Did he not reuse it once again in his cipher wheel? He invented I'm not going to say what he invented. And it isn't his model for the box. And isn't his model for the box of his dimostrazioni, a combination of the camera obscura, invented by somebody else, and Brunelleschi's experiment with the mirror image of the Duomo of Florence. Recombinant thinking would have been second nature to Alberti, who had, we should remember, been trained in the law, in which precedent-based reasoning is most dominant. The Hypnerotomachia makes clear that Alberti thought of previously accumulated knowledge as a thesaurus from which to construct the present unprecedented case. Rather than regarding past accomplishments as an inviolate authority from which to forge imitations, he, like a lawyer, considered them as a knowledge base from which to assemble new constructs. In other words, he saw them as potentially creative rather than constraining. One of Alberti's greatest innovations is to have made this method into a general principle applicable to all areas of creative thinking. The Hypnerotomachia is interesting because it sheds light on the mechanism and the self-reflection of a highly creative mind. Laymen have always wondered greatly, as Freud wrote, like the cardinal who put the question to Ariosto, how that strange thing, the poet, comes by his material, and have wished to gain insight into the creative powers of imaginative writers. But with very few exceptions, creative people themselves have hardly ever been forthcoming on the matter. It makes sense that Alberti would have been one of these exceptions, given his obvious propensity for discovering the laws that made things work. He wrote the first Italian grammar. He set down the rules of perspective. He codified the use of color in painting, formalized the first technique of modern map making, used his knowledge of forces to invent mechanical devices that were influential for Leonardo, devised an ingenious encrypting device that was still used by the US Navy up until the middle of the 19th century, and created a theoretical framework from which all subsequent architectural practice and urban planning derived. It would have been natural for him to have taken the same approach to his own mind and regarded it as a thinking machine. After all, he seems to have been quite conscious of his own ingenio, and it can be argued that his own flattering of anonymous autobiography constitutes the first formulation of the polymath persona of the genius that has been current in culture, Western culture, ever since. Obviously, Alberti thought of dreams as laboratories for his controlled thought experiments, which depended on the algorithm of recombining pre-existing precedents. Dreams do offer ideal conditions, imaginary worlds where transpositions are permitted in a way unconstrained by the demand for reality. In such environments, according to Thomas Kuhn, it is in such environments, according to Thomas Kuhn, that the greatest historical reformulations of physics have occurred, from Aristotle to Galileo, Einstein, and Bohr. This is because a thought experiment, quote, a thought experiment, is one of the essential analytical tools which are deployed during crises and which help to promote basic conceptual reform. From this perspective, the Hypnerotomachia was not only a compendium of everything that Alberti knew, but also a kind of treatise on the laws of the creative process, in which he saw an essence as associative, all-embracing, in a word, Poliphilian. Here, he identified the recombinant thinking characteristic of dream work as an algorithm. The hypnerotomachia is a complement to the Dire Edificatoria. And I go on to show that the same point of view also informs the Dire Edificatoria. I'm going to go into that. Alberti's greatest innovation in the Dire Edificatoria was to have elevated this new way of reasoning associated with this formula for creativity into a theory of modernity. Alberti broke the Vitruvian model of reasoning based on the acceptance of authority of precedent as the ultimate backing in a reasoning process. For the first time, architectural thinking was freed of the arbitrary weight of authority of antique precedent and open to critical inquiry. Leon Battista Alberti is, historically speaking, the first modern. Modern architectural reasoning began at the moment when reasoning based on authority was replaced by reasoning based on rational and critical inquiry. Both types of reasoning are defined by their approach to precedent. In the first case, precedent is seen as a rule or exemplar whose authority dictates that it be strictly emulated. In the second, the authority of precedent is open to question. The approach of the first is imitative, that of the second, creative. All cultures, of course, have an urge to innovate and experiment. As Ernst Robert Curtius points out, the opposition between the ancient and modern already existed in Latin culture. In fact, there's no culture that is not Janus-faced, in which the old is not juxtaposed to the new, in which tradition and rulemaking are not set in opposition to experimentation and rule-breaking. The difference introduced by Alberti is that the balance tips totally in favor of the modern, of change, of new, of progress. For the first time, a kind of architectural reasoning comes into being that rejected the very idea of authority. For the first time in Western thinking, the relative authority of precedence gave way to absolute relativity. Quid tum, what next? This was Alberti's motto. It could have been the motto of no architect prior to him, but it could be the motto of any since. With Alberti, architecture is a dilemma, an ever-present problem, constantly outpacing its solutions, infinitely open to recategorizations and reevaluations of its relation to everything else. Painting, sculpture, drawing, the sciences, engineering, new technologies, language, music, political power, divine experience, gender, nature, civic society, urbanity, regional identity, universal culture, domesticity, morality, reason, and last but not least, passions. As a result, he opened up an age of relativism that has affected architectural thinking ever since. So why the erotic furore? Three reasons. First, as any architect knows, designing First, any creative activity is associated with erotic drive. Ask any architect what it feels like to design. Second, Alberti was very angry. He had just been fired for being a humanist, for doing the kind of work that he did. And he was full of furore, and he wanted to assert. He wanted to leave a legacy of his own life. It was the legacy of a humanist passionately enamored of his life work in the face of great political repression. He was a Republican, and at a time when Republicanism was quashed by the growing absolutist tendencies in Rome in particular. Third, there is the metaphor of the building. There is a deep-seated category of the mind almost, of the anthropomorphic metaphor. The In order to understand why the hypnerotomachia was so erotic, first one has to imagine a world where it's forbidden to love architecture. This is a world where architectural ornament, color, craftsmanship, everything, inspire intense hate and loathing, revulsion and revilement and contempt. Architectural abnegation and abstinence reign. The cult of asceticism and denial of pleasure prevail. In this mentality, dominated by contemptus mundi, denial of architectural pleasure has the mind in its grip. This is Western Europe from the fall of the Roman Empire to about the 8th century. This is a world where change is constricted, inhibited, straitjacketed, to adapt a phrase of Claude Lévi-Strauss, we might call cold thinking. Now think of the hypnerotomachia, a world where architecture is, on the contrary, an object of intense attachment, a world where architectural ornamentation and all those things are objects of frank desire. This is the mid-15th century, the world of the early Italian Renaissance. It's the world where the militant incitements of a generalized amor mundi translates into an equally militant libido edificandi. It's a world characterized by hot thinking, that is, thinking that is committed to change and to creative rethinking, or to use the term of the time, ingenio. Between these two times, a revolution took place. In this world, architectural thinking got turned upside down, to use an expression of Michael Bakhtin. And the human body was the main lever in this process. A radical transition from cold or sterile to modern, hot, or creative architectural thinking between the 8th and 15th century is part of a generalized larger shift in mentality. Lewis Mumford called this rethinking an immense change of mind, which involved the reorientation of wishes, habits, ideals, and goals of the entire Western civilization. On one side of the divide, we have a mindset of the early Middle Ages that prizes ignorance, fatalism, abnegation, and poverty. On the other, we have early Renaissance humanism with a commitment to the cult of knowledge and a belief in unlimited progress. There was another dimension to this paradigm shift, one that might have been more crucial to the overall change of mind, and this was the battle for beauty, for the aestheticizing, hedonizing, and even eroticizing of thinking. Indeed, among the elements of culture to undergo a revolutionary transformation at that time are sexual desire and the body. These are hardly charged concepts by definition. As Michel Foucault wrote in The History of Sexuality, they are the first elements a social order controls in order to control its members. Sexual activity is one aspect of private life that is at the very heart of every society's existence, of its reproduction. Yet eros is also an irrepressible instinct, as Freud pointed out. Plutarch, a philosopher whose work Alberti knew very well and was influenced by, wrote of the longing for being that is the oldest and greatest form of eros. Desire is never easy to tame, and that is why the history of sexuality is such a fascinating subject. And indeed, what we observe during the period during the 8th and the 15th century is a gradual lessening of the older society's grip over sexuality, accompanied by a growing affirmation of desire and erotization of the body. One reason the erotization of the body was so crucial for architecture is the role of the body metaphor in the Renaissance. It's commonplace to say that it is omnipresent in the architecture of the period, but scholars have tended to see it in a limited way as something that gives to buildings their proportion, geometry, and symmetry. This limited view with the concomitant overemphasis on the body metaphor as a unique characteristic of the Renaissance architectural thinking is a result of seriously underestimating the role of anthropomorphy in general. Actually, it is at the heart of every culture. it would appear that there's no part of human culture that has not been steeped in the body metaphor. In this universal capacity, the human body has been seen as a basis for representing or mapping gender, power relations in society, race, the universe, the afterlife, communicating with the divine. The body is one of the instruments for what Lévi-Strauss in La Pensée Sauvage calls the science of the concrete. It acts as a conceptual tool with the multiple possibilities for detotalizing or retotalizing any domain. It serves as a matrix, a genuine system by means of a creature that constitutes the object of thought and furnishes the conceptual tool. According to him, this is because it lets us recognize in all kinds of not yet structured phenomena an organization, an order projected out of the body. Perhaps the reason the body is so entrenched in culture, particularly architectural culture, is that it is pre-wired, or as Leon Battista Alberti would have said, inborn in the mind. Mark Johnson in his Body in the Mind, the bodily basis of meaning, imagination, and reasoning, goes so far as to claim that the body is the basis for the other forms, for all other forms of cognition. All knowledge, in his view, is embodied, meaning that thinking is fundamentally founded upon the anthropomorphic metaphor. For him, the body is a basic category of the mind, a phenomenon. It shapes reality. Close to this radically innatist position is that held by other people who see the most basic level of cognition as a world, as a reflection of the world as is. That is, people view the world. Well, I'm going to go on with that. This is the position put forth by Francisco Varela, Evan Thompson, and Eleanor Roche in The Embodied Mind. During the period under study, given that the body is a universal of thinking, be that as it may, there isn't just one body. Every period, every place has its own definition of the body. During the period under study, that is from the 8th century to the second half of the 15th, the body was not just a metaphor, it was a basic metaphor encapsulating a whole paradigm, a whole conceptual system. And I'm not going to go through that, how the metaphor of the body encapsulates, can encapsulate a whole paradigm, and the effect of this paradigm, breaking the impact of recategorizing the body from something which is the uttermost evil to the highest good, permitted the change in architectural, the formation of humanist thinking and architecture. Due to let's see where we are now. This is the metaphor of the body. Okay. Due to a strange cultural oversight, scholars have tended to overlook the obvious eroticism of the anthropomorphic architectural metaphor, of the eroticism of the anthropomorphic metaphor, architectural metaphor in the early Italian Renaissance, and to see it as the expression of Platonic geometry and proportion. Yet, if there is a prevailing topos in the representation of architecture at this time, it is its unabashed eroticism. This is why Filaretti likens a building the child of the union between architect and patron, and the act of designing to the sexual act. There's no chapter in Francesco Di Giorgio's treatise that does not open with an invocation of the bodily metaphor, and his Corinthian column is a slender body of a young girl and his ideal fortified city, a nude youth. Leonardo's and Cesariano's Vitruvian figure are emphatically virile, and this there's a series of slides are going to show the evolution of the representation of the body. This is the very beginning of the 15th century, and how it becomes more and more eroticized. And this is the famous Cesariano's Vitruvian. is emphatically virile. Alberti opens his discussion in the De Redificatoria about beauty and ornament with the body. The great experts of antiquity, as we mentioned earlier, he writes, have instructed us that a building is very much like an animal and that nature must be imitated when we delineate it. Let us investigate then why some bodies that nature produces may be called beautiful, others less beautiful and even ugly. As an example, he compares a building to a figure of a young girl. One man might prefer the tenderness of a slender girl, yet a character is a comedy preferred by one girl over all others because she is plumper and more buxom. And you might perhaps prefer blah, 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 blah. Similarly, he likens the entrance of a house to its bosom, the columns to bodies with a neck, belly, and navel. From this point of view, the hypnerotomachia is clearly representative of the thinking that characterized Renaissance humanist architecture. It is simply its most oniric, militant, and machic expression. In the Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, the erotization of the body metaphor turned the world upside down. The process of undoing the contemptus mundi mentality that dominated European thinking about architecture for 10th century finished. What began with the dream world of the beginning with a genre called the Mirabilia, is complete. The old patristic ordo rerum has been inverted. Libido, the most abject of all vices in the medieval doctrine, is now elevated to the status of the highest virtue. Much that had been considered an evil has now become a virtue, and conversely, much that had been considered a virtue is condemned. The radical recategorization of the body made this change possible. Humanism represented a transformation not only of the content, but also of the form of architectural thinking. It reconstituted a rethinking of thinking itself. The metaphor of the humanist body is used as a means for sanctioning what we call hot thinking, creative and open to change, over cold thinking, dogmatic and resistance. The logic was one of permission rather than one of prohibitions, risk-taking rather than conservative. This fascinating phenomenon says much about the power of metaphors in representing and categorizing knowledge, about an attempt to reorganize an area of knowledge that created a support system, a new map and links between disparate fields. The body brings together knowledge that would otherwise have been separate and unassociable. The body was a cognitive shortcut, making possible mental leaps that in turn made possible humanist architectural thinking. By opening the way to a restructuring of a specific domain of knowledge, Quattrocento architecture, it changed the very architecture of architectural knowledge. The body itself was a map of the world of architectural thinking, a description of the world that carried within it a set of prohibitions and imperatives. Its transformation from something dangerous to something good led to a cognitive revolution. As a paradigm, it supported the complex organizational structures necessary to remap architectural theory onto the body of the buildings. The reconfiguration of the human body allowed architects to think about their role in the world in a new, creative, humanistic way. It helped turn no into yes. Thank you.
The combination of Greek terms and Latin terms is unacceptable. Throughout the De Redificatoria, he goes to great extent his efforts to introduce Latin neologisms for all the Greek terms that were in Vitruvius. He's a purist in his use of the Latin language. He has tried to return to a sort of form of Ciceronian Latin. And he's a purist in his use of it, of the Italian language. He was one of the founders of the Italian language. The idea that someone such as Alberti could be responsible for the Hypnerotomachia seems to me, from a philological point of view, far-fetched in the extreme. I'd like to know on what grounds you might take that view. And I say this having had this discussion with Giovanni Orlandi, who is the Italian translator of Alberti as well.
Basis for the attribution is philological, actually. And what you say is absolutely correct. He was a purist. He invented the first Italian grammar. He wrote the first Italian grammar. His Latin was exemplary, and it's been his De la Familia is a masterpiece of Renaissance prose. He knew perfect Latin, he knew perfect Greek, and he is well recognized as one of the masters of not only the Tuscan language, which he tried to purify, but Latin and Greek. However, I'm surprised that you are not referring to another family of his works, which are written in a kind of Joycean style, the Intercennalis, for instance, which is the in which he embraces a style of writing which is totally at odds with the style that he projected, that he wrote in the works where he projected a kind of rational persona. I'm surprised that as an expert in Alberti, you haven't referred to the language of Momus, which has sentences that are one page long, that don't have what could be perceived as impurities in them. The language of the Intercennalis has been analyzed by its translator into English, David Marsh, and he has noted the presence of the Golden Age Latin style, but also the Silver Age, which is given to impurity and irregularity and distortions.
I certainly agree with your question about rationality and irrationality, the opposition between the Hypnerotomachia and the erotic. I think that's a false opposition, and I agree with that a lot, but simply on a linguistic point of view. I mean, I stared at Alberti.
But there are texts of Alberti's written in the Hypnerotomachic style. There are. In addition to the purist style. And I'm surprised that you're not referring to those. Well, in addition to describing the material of the building in the Hypnerotomachia, the author of the Hypnerotomachia also describes lineamenti. He has the 50-page description of the triumphal arch is based on lineamenti, on quad.
Quadratura. Not that he's unaware of formal structure, which he is obviously very much, because he gives rules for it, but for example, in at least two places, he speaks in the text specifically about breaking the rules, and he will name them, as you know, about breaking the rule about the number of steps or something like this, which goes very far to say, in the hypnerotomachia, there's something about the presence, the architect's presence before the material that is required, which is not purely, which cannot be held purely in the imagination without the thing itself. Do you see what I mean? A question of judgment, at, you know, in the process of design.
Well, presumably the buildings are designed by someone in the hypnerotomachia. And they are related to, he describes them in terms of concinitas. And he uses the word concinitas, one of the very few people who, other people besides the author of the Re-Edificatoria, to use the word concinitas, which has the same meaning as it does in the Re-Edificatoria, is Alberti, is the author of the Hypnerotomachia. He also describes the relation of the building to idea, and how, which is based on an Albertian definition of concinitas, the twinning of the structure of the mind with the structure of the body. If that's what you mean, there is the presence of the, in the hypnerotomachia and in the Re-Edificatoria of this very, very innovative theory of Alberti's, that beauty in architecture, that the structure of a pleasurable architecture corresponds to something which is innate in the mind.
Right. I would like to say two things. This presentation sort of struck me on two levels. On the one level, I see it as, the same way as I see it in the book, as an important contribution to the scholarship, because what has been achieved is that this text, which has somehow been obscured and not quite acknowledged as an architectural text by the scholarship for all this time, is somehow brought to obscurity, is sort of highlighted and it's sort of analyzed. And certainly, you quite rightly have centered your thesis around the notion of body as something that actually gets promoted, gets established, becomes a main reference to all the points that are being discussed in the book, and both in relation to the story between two individuals and in relation to architecture. So in a way, I would sort of very much sort of be positive about that central thesis, and in a way I think the concept that you sort of develop around it, like the concept of libido, and how that relates to representational structures and how that relates to architecture, the whole vast area that really offers so much to sort of investigate. What still worries me and what still I can't quite realize, although I think this is a major contribution, is why was really the need to sort of attribute the text to Alberti? Because I could see your points that in a way we could, you know, we could see that in a way the person who writes this text, and we should still be reminded that this text emerges 27 years after Alberti's death in Venice, completely unrelated. It emerges 14 years after the first printed version of the Re-Edificatoria. Okay, so why I'm saying that is just to emphasize that in a way the world of Alberti had nothing to do with printed materials, had nothing to do with woodcuts. He was really with dealing with manuscripts. Mm-hmm. Okay, so his world was the world of written letters, not even printed letters. The written and the printed letters, in mm-hmm. a way, only emerged towards the end of his life. Mm-hmm. And there are only one or two obscure texts that might have been printed during his lifetime, 1 or 2 years before his death. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in a way, what I'm actually sort of trying to sort of see is, I would agree that the writer, whoever it was, of Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, was a very good reader of Alberti. because as you sort of rightly mm-hmm. point out,
lots of other
from
yes.
Victoria and from Hypnerotomachia could be related. There is also a kind of general attitude towards the libidinal world, which sort of could be supported by, you know, some things in the internationalis, like the whole dreamlike structure of Alberti's mind, the writing, and so on and so forth. So that, in a way, quite kind of works together. So in a way, one can see that the author is a careful reader of Alberti, mm-hmm. have read his texts very well, but in addition has this completely new thing, which Alberti really never had 20 years before this, and that is this kind of attitude towards representation, which is manifested through the use of drawings. We know that Alberti didn't leave any drawings for us. As you know, the Harvard story, very minor drawings, completely irrelevant. He didn't leave anything of this kind of representations that we see in this book. So it has to be somebody who was, this person, whoever it was, who was writing Hypnerotomachia Poliphili and drawing, if it was the same person, if it was not like two people, must have been somebody who was really very good
very
craftsman,
good.
Mm-hmm. visually practitioner, and all, and so on and so forth. Though Alberti has written the pittura, he couldn't draw. We don't have any drawings. And even when there is evidence, like, you know, as he was drawing, it's kind of not sure what happened to him. Yeah. So in a way, how do you explain? First of all, why did you have to sort of really enforce this attribution, which, you know, a lot of people would find difficult, problematic? All sorts of historiographical kind of data things could be added to, because there is a big gap there.
Yeah.
And second, how do you explain the drawings? Because they would, again, and as I say, these woodcuts, they would again be something that would argue against attribution.
Well, first, I'm not the first person who's connected the who's attributed the Hypnerotomachia to Alberti. Somebody else did, but still, I thought maybe I'll answer the second question first. No, maybe I'll answer the first question first. The reason it doesn't matter really who wrote the Hypnerotomachia. That's it's much more the product of a period than it is. I mean, it changes the view of a period. There is something typically Quattrocento about it, and it could have been whether Alberti wrote it or not is a bit. Could have been irrelevant. It has been irrelevant up until now. The reason I attributed that's the first part of the question. The fact that it the argument about however I do have arguments that they just kept on piling up about why Alberti would have been the author of the Hypnerotomachia. One of them has to do precisely with the visual aspect, what the printed Hypnerotomachia looks like. It's a unique book. No other book comes near it in the Renaissance. It's obviously based on an extraordinary manuscript. The fact that there are 9 images to describe one episode is so unthinkable for the period. It was obviously thought of by somebody who, obviously, book printing was in its infancy. It would have taken. Obviously, there was a genius behind the design of the Hypnerotomachia. So it must have been the design must have been based on a very ingenious manuscript. Alberti didn't leave any drawings, but there are very few drawings left over from the 15th century anyway. Of course, Vasari said he was a horrible artist, but he didn't like Alberti anyhow. He said he was not a very he went because but he was comparing him to Leonardo and to Michelangelo and to great people, and he thought Alberti was just simply a terrible draftsman. He didn't even bother to mention other architectural draftsmen like Di Giorgio or like Filaretti, on the other hand, who have wonderful hands. Wonderful drawing. He didn't even bother to mention those, but he bothered to say that Alberti was bad, and he was jealous of Alberti. So, and there are lots of other, besides Vasari, there are 4 or 5 other contemporaries who praise Alberti's hand. as an artist. One of them was the person who introduced his book, the Reedificatoria, Poliziano. And so he was recognized. He was a recognized graphic artist at the time, and there are I deal with it in the book. There are certain evidences that point to his talent as a visual artist that would explain the hypnerotomachia's shape. Well, they weren't all grouped together before. They you wouldn't have found anybody who was an engineer and poet and novelist and the disciplines really were not invented before the hypnerotomachia. Well, I don't know if they were invented or not, but well, the
only from a later perspective, it takes on this quality
of seeing dreamlike associations. Well, I can't think of anybody else who brings together all these. I can't think of any other work of the period that brings together all these things in one, in between two covers.
Resting the
I'd like to thank Liane, but also I'd like you to ask who's kind of like a stay for a moment, because they want to show like how the text can be put on the website. I'm afraid I'm the end of that.
Okay.
Issues.
He's right.
Now the real break is coming.
Now, yes, the real break is coming.
We actually put the whole book on the web, so if you type in Hypnerotomachia Poliphili, you will actually either on Yahoo or Alta Vista or any other search. The DKS at TU Delft. The site itself is divided into portions of it as Liane's book. And then the whole, you can get the whole book, which is divided into chapters, which come in as draw caps, and you can, if you click on the draw caps, you get a thumbnail of the whole chapter. You can click on one of those images and get a large view, and then you can browse through either by images, if you don't want to read the text and you just want to see the images, you can browse through the images. Besides that, there's on Liane's site, there is the sequences that Liane spoke about, the filmic sequences, and some animations.
Animated.
Right. Right, and we're wondering whether. It's in the cafeteria, it's in the buffet area.
In the bar. That's
in the bar.
Okay, well, before everyone runs off, I'd like to thank you.